where would people never notice a town full of robots? Connecticut.
But why are we moving to Connecticut?
We're moving so that we can all kick back and have a great new life in this beautiful new town.
Remember, it's just pretend. Only make believe.
Do you ever imagine things? Are they scary things? Are they scary things?
Was it just an ordinary morning? December 14th,
it was.
2012.
We had forgotten that Nate had book club mm-hmm. at 8 in the morning.
There were a couple of strange things.
They weren't getting on the bus. So I said, all right, guys, we got to hurry up and get the dishes in the dishwasher because we got to get Nate to school. And then I said to Ben, all right, so do you want to come back and wait for the bus or do you want to go and have a treat? And he went, go have a treat.
I get it myself, but I don't have sums. Yum, 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 yum. It's bacon. I love you. I love bacon. I love you.
I can bring home a bacon. Fry it up in a pan.
It was sizzling.
So after his super successful business trip, you know what Steve does? He brings home the bacon!
Daddy's home!
Hi, Dad. Mm-hmm.
So we dropped off Nate at school, and we went to the coffee shop, and we sat down, and
because he was a big Starbucks fan.
He
right?
was.
Glenn! Glenn, Glenn, Glenn! Glenn, Glenn, Glenn! Glenn, Glenn, Glenn! Glenn's the man going to work. Got his tie. Middle management is right in his grasp. It's a dream he will never let die.
Before, actually, while we were getting the dishes in the dishwasher, he said, oh, out of the blue, hey, Mom, what does forgiveness mean? And I was like, I don't know. It's like when somebody does something wrong and you forget about it. And he was like, huh, I didn't think about it. We go to Starbucks after we drop off Nate.
Because he loved hot chocolate.
He loved hot chocolate. Loved anything chocolate. Mm-hmm.
Augustus, sweetheart, save some room for later.
Oh, Augustus, please, don't do that. My chocolate must never be touched by human hands. Please, don't do that. Don't do that. You're contaminating my entire river. Please, I beg you, Augustus. My chocolate. My chocolate. My beautiful chocolate.
Don't just stand there. Do something.
Help. Police. Murder.
And we sat down, and there's two parts to the story. One is that we sat down, and he said to me, just right there, he said, Mama, I'm going to be an architect. And I said, oh, that's great. He said, oh, but I have to be a paleontologist, too. And I said, why? He said, because Nate's going to be a paleontologist, and I have to do everything Nate does.
Wow.
And I said, well, he said, I'm going to do everything Nate does, Mommy. And I said, well, you know, you're your own person. You don't have to. He said, no, I want to. And we sat there, and I said, so nice to be with you. So after he died, I started to question, like, you know, maybe that conversation wasn't as special as I have remembered it. Maybe I had made it up. Maybe it didn't really happen.
Mm-hmm. Now, what if I take nothing and blow your head off with nothing? That'd be something, wouldn't it?
It sure would.
We sat there and waited until we were told early that afternoon that if you were in that room waiting, then the person you were waiting for wasn't going to be coming back. Shortly before we moved from England, Dylan was diagnosed with autism, and he was a flapper. He would flap his arms up and down whenever he was excited or happy, and it was truly joyful to watch because he was such a happy little boy. But I asked him once, why do you flap? And he told me, because I'm a beautiful butterfly.
I'm finished! Finally, I'm a beautiful butterfly! My wings! Oh, they're beautiful!
I'm like the wagon's taking off! You better start
still flying!
But I am flying! And from way up here, you all look like little ants!
So, at his memorial service, when my husband and I were speaking of Dylan, I spoke about how he was now our butterfly, and that if a butterfly, you know, there's a saying that if a butterfly flaps its wings in one place, it can cause a hurricane halfway around the world.
The movie in your head is broken, that's all.
And I said that Dylan and all the others that died that day were now our butterflies, and that they were going to drive a change across the country, if not the world.
Look at the camera. Think about the people. Think about the babies, the children. You know what I'm saying? Save the babies, brother. Save the babies, brother. Save the babies.
People and children and TV land and all the little kids around the world.
Come with me and you'll be in a world of pure imagination.
Your son forgot something on Friday morning, so you went up to the school. And that's when right. You got there, you knew something was amiss, to say the least.
Yes.
What did you see?
There were like 8 or 10 kids who were, you know, running basically towards the firehouse. And I obviously thought that was odd. But when I got out of the car and started walking towards the building, I noticed a car, you know, in the drop-off area in front of the entrance, like a black hatchback, had all the doors open and like black sweatshirts strewn around it. And again, I thought, well, that's really odd. You know, you don't usually see that at the school.
I'm sorry to interrupt what I'm sure would have been a very well-rehearsed story, but since you can produce no witnesses of the event...
Pardon me, Minister, but as it happens, we can.
I ain't afraid of no ghosts.
And then I walked to the doorway, and there was another mom standing there, and all the while I'm thinking to myself, the building is so quiet, and why is it so quiet? And I said to her, is something going on? And she goes, I don't know, but look. And she pointed and I looked, and next to the door where there's a buzzer, you have to buzz into the building.
Yeah, spit it out.
Young lady, I think you'd better.
The whole plate glass window to the right of the door was shattered, and there was glass everywhere. And we looked at that and we said, well, you know, this is really strange. And as soon as those words kind of came out of our mouth, we started hearing gunshots.
I got you!
No, you didn't!
I got you!
No, you didn't!
I got you! I came right here! I got you!
No, you didn't! I told you I'm poor!
I knew that it was gunfire, but, you know, I didn't... I just ran, you know, I just ran.
Mikey, does that sound like gunshots? Yeah. Not the big ones that you hear in war movies, but gunshots. Real ones. They're gonna kill us.
Jeez, Chunk, turn off your brain, right? Someone probably dropped the pot.
Yeah, pot. Just dropped the pot. It's
are you sure, Mikey?
It was about an hour into it. I knew that she was gone, that she was not going to be there.
Where is the strength coming from? If someone's watching this and they say, you know, it's the complete opposite picture, you would see what they might think a parent would be looking like.
Some people say, well, she's not grieving the right way. And it's the mom that said, I just want her to be proud of me.
This place does something to people. All of the women are always busy and perfect and smiling, and all of the men are always happy.
And that's a problem because?
Because it's not normal, Walter.
It was cold that day, and when she got on the bus, I was on the porch and Jeremy was in the driveway, and the last thing we saw was her gigantic grin. She's got an infectious grin, and...
Let's put a smile on that face.
And
why so serious?
She was waving to us from the bus, and that's the last time we saw her. And she was beautiful.
You went to the funeral home, and you were telling me the story of she has a white casket.
She does. And
when we walked in the room. It was the first time we had been able to be with her. And when we walked in the room and we saw that white casket, it just, you felt like the floor was falling out beneath you and your breath was taken away. But earlier in the morning, I decided, because Grace loved art so much, we were packing Sharpies in our pockets.
This is my art and it is dangerous!
And when we got in, after we did our big family hug with Grace, we sat down and we busted out the Sharpies and we decided that we were, at first I envisioned maybe a little heart, but by the time we were done, there wasn't an inch of white. It was so covered with all the things that she loved, and her brother, we wrote her notes and her nicknames and all the things that she loved.
The cupcakes, places we've been together.
Ice cream cones, lighthouses, seagulls, and we were saying she is laughing at us right now because our artwork was terrible.
See, I told you. They are a joke. Right?
It's a joke. It's a showtime joke.
Showtime.
Bravo! Well done. Aren't they delightful? Aren't they charming?
I do say that all seemed rather rehearsed.
Like they knew what was going to happen.
Oh, poppycock.
And this is probably the culminating event that made it as bad as it can possibly get. And we got to start somewhere, and I guess Newtown, Connecticut was the place where I had to start. But I plan to, till my dying day, make a difference.